You are just raise a hallelujah to him. So we started this service and Faith said, raise your hand and raise your other hand. We could all dance. I'm not seeing a huge amount of dancing out there. We're singing some amazing, amazing things. We have such a good God. We can sing in the middle of a storm. It doesn't matter where we are. It doesn't matter what our circumstances are telling us, what we've had in the week. I know some of us have had horrible weeks. It doesn't matter because we can sing in the middle of that storm. So let's sing this. And just raise your hands and just thank him that we can sing in the middle of the storm. We can sing louder and louder and louder. And I won't make you sing that refrain over and over until we raise the roof. But maybe I will. It depends how loud we get. But let's just raise our voices to him today because he has done so much for us. Death is defeated. The king is alive. We're going to celebrate around communion later. That's something we can praise him for. So let's go for... I'm going to sing in the middle of the storm.
In the middle of the storm. your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones, all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all.
Greatest, your name, it stands above. There's still power in the name of Jesus. That at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Power of the name of Jesus. You know, we're going to come around communion now. And I very quickly just want for a few moments to talk about the power of communion. I want to read a few verses from 1 Corinthians 11. If you've got your Bibles or your phones or your iPads, just look there for a second. In 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23 says this, "For what I received from the Lord, what I also passed on to you, the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Three quick points. First one, proclamation. Proclaim. We proclaim. We proclaim. The Passion Translation puts it like this. "Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are retelling the story, proclaiming our Lord's death until he comes." What are we proclaiming? That Jesus died, buried, and rose again. Let me say that again, because I think there's some Pentecostals in the room. We are proclaiming that Jesus died, buried, and rose again. The gospel is not just the death of Christ, it's the resurrection of Christ. It's the power of God unto salvation. And who are we proclaiming this to? The world. We're proclaiming this to the world, that our Jesus died, was buried, and rose again from the dead. Secondly, remembrance. We remember Jesus dying on the cross for us, the most cruelest of deaths that the Romans could ever make up. This is the ultimate expression of love. I find it really interesting when it says, "Do this in remembrance of me." I think the writer put it in here to remember this, because you know what? As human beings, we forget stuff, don't we? In remembrance of me. So every time we come together, when you break bread at home, when we come together once a month and we do this at church, we remember, we call to mind, we bring back the remembrance of the cost and the price that was paid for you and me. Church, we can never forget the death of Jesus. We can never forget the resurrection of Jesus. This is who we are. Without the shedding of blood, there can be no forgiveness of sins. Without Jesus dying on the cross and rising again from the dead, you and I would not be sat here this morning. There would be no such thing called church. But because of his death, his burial, and his resurrection, we remember. We remember. So when you feel down, when you have difficulties in your life, like Abby was encouraging earlier, no matter what sort of week that you had, you know, we get to come to the cross. And we get to come to break bread. And we get to drink from this cup. And you know what? Problems may be massive, but God is bigger. Pains and aches may really, really hurt, but you know what? Our God is still healer. We come to the one and we remember who he is and what he's done. The last one, anticipation until he comes. We're just going to keep doing this until Jesus comes back. You know he's coming back, don't you? Are you sure? He's coming back. He's coming back for his church. Do you know where you're going? I hope you know where you're going. The purpose of the cross was to bring us salvation. To bring us salvation. And part of salvation is our future eternity with him. You won't get to live in this body all the rest of your life, because eternity means we're going to be like him. You won't have any aches anymore. No more wrinkles. All those things will be gone because we will be like him. And we get to spend eternity in his house without a mortgage. We get to spend eternity with God. And so with the anticipation of Jesus' return, the action, the preparation, this expression of faith that, you know, we're just journeying through. I mentioned right at the start of the service, we're going on this journey with God. We're just passing through this place. This is not our home. But we'll do this in remembrance of who He is. That anticipation means, you know what? I'm just going to realign myself with God right now. Because the importance we have as we come around the table and we break bread and we drink cup, that, you know, we haven't time to go through it all, but it means you and I have to realign ourselves with God. We've got to make sure that our lives, our hearts, our minds, our actions are all in line with His. And if it's not, I believe Scripture says this, well, don't let it pass by and then put it right. I believe Scripture says put it right so you can partake. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Let's bow our heads. Let's close our eyes for a moment. You know, maybe there's some things you just need to realign yourself with God right now. Before this bread comes round and before this cup comes round, maybe there's some things in your heart that just need readjusting. Maybe there's some thinking processes that just need readjusting. Say, God, I just realign myself with you right now. God, if there's anything, like David said, God, if there's anything wicked in my heart, God, would you search me? Would you just search out those things in my heart that maybe aren't from you? Maybe that way of thinking just needs to change right now. And we pray, Holy Spirit, would you realign our thinking process to yours? And if we've got any sin in our lives, God, we just confess it before you right now. We lay it at the cross. Because you bought salvation for us, and we know because you are true and you are just, as we come before you, God, you will forgive us. Anything we need to put right, we do it right now. So when this bread comes round and this cup comes round, we can take this in right relationship with God because we've realigned ourselves with Him right here, right now. This already is a journey. So we're going to pass around the bread and the cup. And parents, this morning, you know, involve your children. Getting to take a piece of bread and cup. And if you just want to sit as a family or stand as a family or find some space and just have communion with your children, then please do that. It's really important. Our children need to know who Jesus is. So we're going to pass around this bread and pass around this cup. Take some time between you and God and just thank Him for your salvation. If you want to get alongside somebody else and just do that, or somebody that sat beside you and join together and pray, then please do this. We are a family. So, Father, we thank you for this bread that represents the body of Jesus Christ, and this juice and a little cup that represents the blood of Christ. We thank you. We thank you for your amazing love. For God so loved the world that He gave. As we prepare our hearts now to receive, we remember the greatest gift of all, that no greater love than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends. Thank you, Jesus. Bless you, God.
For your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hand. The moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love you, Lord. For your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands.
tell him how good he is. Lift your voice and tell him of his goodness, his faithfulness. Thank him for his healing touch. Whatever he's done in your life, take a moment and just give him thanks. Give him thanks for your salvation, for your family. Oh God, we bless you in this place this morning. Father, your goodness just overflows in our life. Lord, we pray those people who don't know you will be jealous of the fact that goodness is flowing from our lives. And because of that jealousy, Father, want to know you as Lord and Savior. We thank you for your goodness, God. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your goodness, God. In Jesus' name we pray. 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 I can't hear you, church. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 We bless you, God. We bless you, God. Amen, church. You may be seated. Oh, all those years of Pentecostalism is coming out now. I just love Jesus. Is that all right? It's okay if your pastor gets a little bit excited. A bit tough, I got the microphone. Really, really great. I just love the goodness. I love songs like this because it recaptures my heart again. That your goodness, and goodness. God, your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. Like Scripture says, the sun rises every day, proves the faithfulness of God and who he is. Amen? Amen. Okay, we're just going to release our children at this time. Our young people are staying down this morning. Your program starts next week. And so apologies for that. We have a new team and a new program, and that will kick off next Sunday morning. Have a great time upstairs. I love all the excitement. Have a great time. Okay, pop the announcements on there for me, Callum, please. Okay. Let me give a few announcements because we're kicking back off with our programs this week. And so we need you to pop along and be with us as we start a few things on this week. Wednesday night, we'll restart our Bible studies. We had a little bit of a break in August. So this Wednesday night, we're beginning to start the whole series on Psalm chapter 2. I mentioned last week to you, I think this is very significant in the times and the ages in which we're living, because there's four scenes in it, and I put it in the newsletter to you a couple of weeks ago. The first scene is all about Satan's agenda. You know the enemy has a plan. You know God's plan is greater. Okay, so we need to understand the plan of the enemy, and so we're going to look at some of this stuff, and we're going to unpack some of this stuff on Wednesday night. I'm getting so excited, I'm going to be here a day early. So Wednesday night, 7:30, come along. We'll have a time of worship, a time of teaching, and a time of prayer together. So I encourage you to do that. Pastor Ely is with us in a couple of weeks' time. He's one of the missionaries that we support, and he's from Beirut, and so he'll be with us on Sunday the 17th. He's with us for 3 or 4 days. I did send a message out to some of my leaders. He needs a place to stay. If you can help with accommodation, please come and let me know. The church will cover any cost that's involved in there. Also, I think he might need a car. He might have one. I'm still talking back and forth with him. He may need to borrow a car for a few days. If you can help, please come and speak to me at the end. Again, we can cover and help with some costs of that. But he will be with us. He's got a few stories to tell, as you can imagine being in Beirut in Lebanon. So he will be with us for that particular Sunday. This Friday night, we're having three prayer meetings once a month right through to November. And then in December, we're going to have a Christmas party. So Friday the 8th, so this Friday night, 7:30, come along. We're going to spend some time in worship. We're going to spend some time in prayer. We're going to spend some time in praying over our schools, our education system, that sort of thing. I'm praying for each other. So please bring any prayer requests along. If you can't make it for any reason, can you drop me a text or an email or whatever, and we will bring that prayer request in on Friday evening. But it'd be great to see as many people here as possible. Prayer changes things. So we want to encourage you to come along 7:30 on Friday night. And who knows, we could all end up at McDonald's afterwards. We don't know. That might get some of you here. I don't know. 7:30. Next Sunday morning, we're continuing on the series I've been looking at for the last few months on the preeminence of Christ. And so we're going to begin to look at the Godhead or the Trinity. And I've done a lot of study in this, and I still can't get my head around it. the Trinity, how do you explain the Trinity? Anyway, the Godhead, so we're going to look at this. So next Sunday morning, we're going to look at God the Father. And then the next time I'm speaking, God the Son, and the next time, God the Holy Spirit. So God the Father, we will look at next Sunday morning. With some prayer, again, I've put this all over Facebook and sent it out to you. Elam are having some prayer from Tuesday through to Thursday, 19th to the 21st, online and in the evenings. It's all on their Facebook page and on their YouTube page. So if you can, in the mornings, for those few mornings, 7:30 to 8:30, there's some devotionals. Just log into that. It's all free. Just get into that. And again, just encourage us some prayer. We're part of a network that's bigger than us. There's over 550 Elam churches within the UK alone, and we're international worldwide. And so if you can be part of that, get into that. There'll be several hundred people just on there in the morning and just having some devotionals. So if you can just log into that, then it will just be something to encourage you those three particular days. I mentioned last week we have a missionary couple who've been with us on the 8th of October, and they work with the Muslim Kurds and the Kurds of London, and that's what they do. So I can't put their name up because of safety. And also in that particular morning, we won't record it, so you really need to be here in that morning. We've known him for many, many years. He happens to be Irish, so we'll have some subtitles for him. So he will be here, him and his wife will be here in that particular morning, so I really want to encourage you to come along to that morning on the 8th. We have a church app, and so again, it's on the on the area coming in on the notice board. I did send it out to you. It's on our Facebook as well. Download the app. Everything, we can get rid of all the WhatsApp groups, we can put it all under one. That means all the announcements, all little things, come up, just come up on your phone, it'll highlight it, notification, and that will be done. Hannah was going to be here this morning, and she's put the whole thing together, and she was away on holiday last week, and she says, Dad, did you get your phone out and get them all to download it and talk them through it? No, I don't know how to do that. So she said she was going to do it this morning, but she's not well, and she starts her new job tomorrow. She's qualified as a nurse, so she's got her first 12-hour shift tomorrow as a nurse, but she's not well, so she left her in bed this morning. But please do download it. It's really quite easy. It's just another app, and then click on it. It's all there. Follow all the instructions out there. If you need some help with it, then we'll point you towards Alan or somebody who knows what to do. Okay. Again, I've mentioned we're looking for a new building or somewhere to rent, somewhere we can expand a little bit. I have this vision that I don't want to get into now, but God's just been talking to me the last couple of weeks again about it, but the whole thing of being just a resource center within Peterborough and how we begin to do that. And so I brought this through at the AGM way back in April. So we're having two particular offerings, one in October and one in April, which is beyond our normal tithes, and we want to begin to do that. We've set some money aside for a building or rental, but we're having these two offerings a year, and you can give extra into that. If you can do that and gift aid that, then we'll lay that money aside and we'll begin to look to the future and what God's got for us. You know, if God's got something planned for us a few years down the line, we've got to be intentional about it now. So we begin to put those things in place. Joseph's storehouse, you know, upstairs. So again, if you can bring any non-perishable goods with you, we have a room upstairs that we store them. We have lots of different ministries going on in the church. If you can help us with all the forms at the back, please fill those forms in. Put your details in there. Certain things like kids and youth ministry, you need to go through DBS check-in. All these processes put in place will be mentored into that particular ministry. So again, if you can help us with those things, then please do. Okay, I think that's everything that I'm going to say. Okay, are you sitting comfortably? The children's morning we're going to have on the 24th. We've had to move that because some families aren't here in a particular morning. So we will get another morning that we'll spend some time and just making a fuss of our kids and giving them gifts and all sorts of stuff. But we'll give you that date as soon as we rearrange that. Okay, we're sitting comfortably. Have you got your Bibles? You're all happy this morning because I'm not preaching, aren't you? Yeah, I can see it in some of your faces. Okay, we got a guest speaker with us. We've flown them all the way from Whittlesea. And brought them in, no expense spared. And so please can we put your hands together for Mrs. Helen Topping. Yeah, let me pray for you. Okay, let's just pray. Father, we just want to thank you for Helen. Lord, for her journey, for her love for you, for her faithfulness to you. And Father, all the preparations, and I know the preparations that have been put in place, Lord, to put all this together this morning. And Father, even, Lord, she might be a little bit nervous, but Lord, we know she stands on your word, and she stands in faith, and she stands, Lord, to you, Lord, because you're her heavenly Father. And we know, Holy Spirit, as you would just begin to unpack some of the stuff that you've laid upon our heart, God, we know as a church, Father, we will be better for hearing your word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Okay, good morning. I avoid speaking in front of the church at many costs, and it's taken Phil over 5 years to get me up here. And it came about by talking about testimonies and sharing testimonies. And then we were on a holiday, and I was sharing a dream that that I had. And Phil was like, that's it. You've got to share that. And it's just gone on and on and on. I'm going to need the slides on at some point. It's called, yeah. Phil's going to pop them on. I've got my tissues. I don't cry because I'm sad. So when I get overwhelmed, because I'm going over some of my childhood, what will happen is I will get a little bit overwhelmed at the reality of what God has done. Even faith worshiping this morning, we're singing Goodness of God. And when you sing a song like that and you focus on those words of just how good God is, we just get choked up. You can see it getting choked up. And then I was getting choked up. I'm like, because when you know who God is, sometimes you're just standing, you're just sometimes just in awe. Sometimes words are not enough. So I didn't want it to be about me. And when I was sharing this and I was going through it, I was like, God, but what is the point? There has to be a purpose to me sharing this morning. And it only came to me this morning. So I was straightening my hair, and it will make sense as I was smelling the burning. And God was like, that's it. And he kept me right until the brink, which doesn't make me comfortable. I'm a teacher by profession, and I do everything organized, methodically, and very much ahead. So this is not like me at all. So going on a journey, when I got baptized, I don't know what age I was, so a lot of this is going to be to and fro in, but I was mid-teen when I got baptized. And this was the scripture that was given to me. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. And I think New King James Version says, and he will direct your paths. Both of them interlink with the Hebrew anyway. I actually like the he will direct your paths, because I know that it's not always, it doesn't feel straight. It is straight in God, but it doesn't always feel like that. So next slide. So I'm going to go through a little bit of a timeline of points in my life, and then what God was talking to me about when we were on holiday, and we're just quietening myself. And then I've got a challenge for you that I believe is very much from the heart of God. So I'm going to come back to that scripture, but I wanted to start with it. There are going to be scriptures on the board. I'm going to get you guys to read this out. So be prepared to join in and to, as a group, as a fellowship, read scripture out. So we're going to read the first scripture, Psalm 139, verse 13 to 14 together. And it says, for you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know full well. At the age of 7, I didn't know that I was fearfully and wonderfully made, but I had a joy. I didn't know God at all. I wasn't a Christian at this time. And God, when I was on holiday, I had this dream, and this was the first memory that God gave me. And I was 7, and my mum and dad will probably remember this. You weren't with me at the time, but you heard about it. I was taking my dog on a walk with my sister, and I was always singing. I was always performing as a child. I'd be singing on the tables at school and performing as much as I could, because I got a real joy out of it. And I was walking my dog with my sister, singing about everything that I could see. Singing about the trees, the flowers, anything that was natural, I was just singing about it. And there was a real joy, and I was laughing, and I was crying, and I was singing, and just making up songs. And my sister was absolutely in hysterics, just laughing at me. She was like, stop, stop. I was like, I can't, I'm just going to keep singing. And I was singing. That was the first memory that God gave me. I didn't know at the time what that was about. I'm going to jump onto the next slide. It's all going to weave together. Going to jump right onto about the age of 12, Father's heart. So there's some key words on there that are linking very much to what I'm saying. So when I was young, my my dad played guitar and sang as just as a hobby, something that he enjoyed to do, and he was teaching my brother how to play the guitar for a couple of years, actually, but he didn't really take to it. And I used to, I don't know if he knows this, but I used to sit outside the bedroom thinking, please teach me, I really want to learn to play the guitar. And I think I probably used to ask him, like, I'm on teaching Brett, and, you know, and that was kind of it. Eventually, my turn came, where he taught me how to play three chords. And he said, Helen, if you want to get good, you've got to practice these three chords. You've got to practice them every day for 20 minutes, half an hour. I took it literally. I practiced every day. I said to Phil, I can imagine how annoying that must have been for everyone else in the house. And one of four children, there's four of us. I must have drove them absolutely insane, playing my guitar, learning songs. And I practiced and I practiced and I practiced. And I wrote my own little songs about nature and all wonderful things like that. And I put on there the Father's heart. You see, my dad gave me a gift, but he didn't know what that gift would mean. But how amazing. What God said to me when he showed me this is, your natural father gave you that gift, but how much more does the Father heart of God prepare you for things? Because that was part of his preparing for future, for something else. So he was already in the working. He was already in the detail. I didn't know my Father in heaven, but he knew me. He knew me when I was seven and I was singing down the street and I was appreciating the beautiful things around me. I didn't know him then, but he knew me and he was preparing my heart. So, you know, I thank my earthly father for giving me that gift. My heavenly father was using and preparing that way. Next slide. So jumping on to the age of 16. So still not a Christian. Around the age, again, mid-teens, I don't know the age exactly, but we had an invitation through a member of my family to go to a church. My dad got saved first, that's his testimony to give. And then my mum and then myself, my sister, all became Christians. Now, my first experience of a church was not that one. I'd been to a very traditional church with my best friend who was a Christian. She was really smart at school and I wasn't, so I thought if I went to church with her and learnt about Jesus, that I would be smart too. It didn't work. I went once, I sat on a pew, everybody had hats on. It was very traditional and I was told off for sitting in someone's space. Hence to say, I didn't go back again. I was absolutely mortified and embarrassed that I'd been picked on like that. So this was my first Pentecostal church, Assemblies of God, in Derbyshire. And I walked into the church from family, and the first thing that got me, age probably 15, was the worship. The worship was vibrant, it was lively, there was joy in the house. People were just smiling and happy. The worship leader, Joe, her name was amazing, like just worshipped in the spirit. They were praying in tongues. I didn't know what that was, but I laughed a lot, so it was funny. People were raising their hands and clapping and dancing. People were falling down on the floor under the presence of God. I'd never seen anything like it. I didn't know what it was. I didn't understand it, but I just knew that it was good. And I knew that I wanted to be a part of that, and I knew that I wanted to accept Jesus as my saviour, but it was the worship was the connection with God. That was what really got me. So, you know, today with a lot of churches, we talk about being seeker-friendly. This wouldn't have been classified as a seeker-friendly church, but it was Holy Spirit-filled, and that's what connected. Because we are made, God creates us to know him, to live with him. So we don't even hear, we don't make excuses, or we're not going to go easy on the presence of God. That is very much our hearts, to go for the presence of God, the anointing, the passion, and we don't hold back from that. So yeah, it was the worship that really connected me in with my Father in heaven, and then came the journey of worship. My parents were involved in youth work. I got involved in the worship. Dad looked after the worship team for the youth, and we got to travel around. I was leading worship, did some schools work, working in singing. It was all praise and worship. And we evangelized and we shared God's love through music. At the time, I was more writing songs and writing stories, writing about our life story and ministering through that. So very upfront. That was early teens. well, mid to late teens, I was still a very raw Christian, not very grounded in my Bible. All I knew is I knew that God was real. I'd had a personal experience with him. I pestered the pastor to get me baptized. I pestered the pastor to pray with me so that I could be filled with the Holy Spirit. Nobody told me about these things. I just saw it and I was like, I want to do what they're doing. It was in the Bible, you know, and I was annoying. I'm sure I was annoying. We used to go to prayer meetings in the week, long-winded prayer meetings. I used to sit with my guitar, and the pastor, John, Irish guy, was a musician as well, but he used to come to me, and he was the one that really encouraged me in the singing. And he said, no, don't sing like that. I want you to sing like this. I want you to practice like this. Every word that you sing has got to be really clear. Every word that you sing, you have to mean every word that you sing. And every week he'd come and listen to me. He's like, right, you've got it now. You've got it. I can tell what you're singing. I'd had a very thick Derbyshire dialect, so it didn't always come across very well. So he really impacted me and encouraged me to work on the words. God, on the other hand, was working on the spirit within me. During that time, I'd shut myself in my room at home, and the worship experiences that I used to have were so deep. I used to sit at home playing my guitar and worship. Joe used to give me all the songs on paper, they were then. At the end of every Sunday, she'd give me songs to go and practice. And I'd go home and I'd practice and I'd worship with them. And in that place, God absolutely broke me in a good way, because he healed me from so much, a lot of emotional hurt. And he just revealed himself to me through those really deep experiences of worship. It's not for me, worship is not singing songs. I know it's the great thing, it's a whole lifestyle that we're committing to God. But when you sing or when you pray and you're telling him just how amazing he is, and you're just pouring your life out to him, he just really impacts you. He can't help himself. He loves us that much. And so my connection was worship. I know it's not everyone's, but it was mine, and that's how he got my heart. You see, he revealed himself to me very young. I just didn't know. I found him, and I accepted him in my teens, but then I looked back, and he was always there. I just didn't know it. Around the age of 17, I had a desire to go into Bible college. Another testimony, but I left school without any qualifications. That's another story in itself. But to go to Bible college, I needed my GCSEs. Didn't have them. Well, I had one, that was PE. Everything else I didn't take much notice of. And I certainly didn't have A-levels. You needed J-levels to get into Bible college. I really wanted to go. I wanted to study the Bible. I wanted to learn more about Jesus. I wanted to get away and do it. And I applied, and they said, right, you've got to write this essay for us. It was on Acts 2. And I had to study Acts and write a response to a question that they'd given me if I was a title. I thought, I don't know how I'm going to do this. So I went back to the prayer room, went back to the worship room. I fasted and prayed for 7 days. My dad baked me unleavened bread. I don't know if you remember doing it, bringing bread up to my bedroom with water. And that's what I did for a whole week. Prayed, worshipped, wrote what I thought I needed to write. No idea if it made sense. God had his favour on that, and I got accepted, and I went into Bible college, Assemblies of God Bible College. In the Bible college, God then used the worship. I became one of the worship leaders. I was told I was the first female worship leader in Assemblies of God. That's what I was told at the time. And our principal, Dr. David Petz, bless his soul, used to love worship, but he was known as a Holy Spirit man, but still very structured in his worship. When I used to lead the worship, he used to fall down prostrate on his face, and he used to come to me afterwards and say, I just, when you worship, it's just something, you know, it's just something that makes me want to bow down before God, and it was really special. I did that for 2 years, learning more about the Bible. That's where I met Phil, and then God took me on another journey, still very raw. I became a pastor's wife at the age of 21. Not a Christian very long, as you can see. Not grounded in the Bible, not really. God took me on a super speedy roller coaster, really, to learn about him, to equip me, to get me ready. The churches we were in at the start were really, really gracious. Just tracking back a little bit, Peterborough was our first connection when we were at Bible College. We came down to an Assemblies of God church in Werrington. That was our base. That was, and we came, and I was mentored there by the worship leader's son, Mark Wright, and he showed me. He was so passionate when he used to lead worship on the guitar, and that really impacted me. He was passionate that people would really worship and get God, and when people didn't worship, he used to get really annoyed and frustrated. But I loved his passion and his rawness and his edginess, and that impacted me as well. That was something that I took. So we were at Peterborough at the age, I'd have been 20, before we even came as part of the church when it was in the Alpha Centre. So we had three connections with the church. God was already preparing a way. He was already saying, this is what... We didn't know at the time, this is you're going to be coming full circle, and this is the end destination, so to speak. So Bible College, gone from that. My next bit, we skip along to next one. And next one. Okay, so this one is God. So God showed me all these little places in my timeline, and what he was saying to me is, I've been in there in the detail, you just didn't know it. But I've worked everything together, all things together. Your word is a lamp to guide my feet for my path. There's no greater joy for a mother or a father than to share a gift with their children. And my greatest gift that I've really has meant the most to me has been sharing, yes, Jesus with my children, but sharing the gift of worship. That was really important to us as a family. Phil's a worshipper. Everything's worship in our house. So from being yay high, Hannah was singing at the age of 2. Faith joined the worship band about the age of 9 because we had no band when we were in Blackpool. So she was playing, maybe a bit younger, playing the piano, very simple chords. But we just used to sit at home and worship. And it was really special. And we did that right the way through. So we're really passionate about worship. My desire has always been to give, impart, share something with my children that's really impacted me, and just pray that God just breathes on it and takes them so much further and so much deeper than what I've ever experienced, because he does that. He's a good God, and I see that already. And I'm thankful for God that he's took me on that journey so far, that now I get to see my children, our children, growing and fulfilling God's plan for their lives, but in worship as well, just because I love the worship. Teaching my children to worship was and still is a joy. And all the way through, what happens is God shows that he's in control. I've not shared the very emotional bits, because I really wouldn't be able to share them without getting emotional. But everybody's got a journey. I have had a very interesting journey. I've had big choices to make. Even when it comes to going into teaching, that was given to me by a prophetic word. So I'll never be a teacher. I don't have the qualifications to be a teacher. Prophet Sharon Stone prophesied that, and I actually publicly was, no, she's wrong. She's wrong. That was for someone else. And then God took me on this journey where somebody else, I was doing volunteer work in a school, and the teacher says, you need to be a teacher. And I've been, and even financially was supported all the way through that from every school I've been in. So there was, it's incredible how God works. So even when I wasn't looking for it, it was handed to me on a plate. I didn't have to go searching for it. I didn't have to go looking for it. God's plan, it was there for me. All I had to do was accept it and take it and go on that plan. He does that with everything. He's done that with the worship. He does it in every area of our lives. He's interested in the detail, and he has a perfect plan, and we just have to listen and obey and take it. I find in my Christian walk that I've never really had to strive for anything. I find that God, for me, even in difficult times, God always meets me. I just have to listen, spend time with him, go through the course of what he's trying to teach me. When things are really difficult and really painful, I don't, oh God, you're putting me through this. I'm like, okay, God, what do you want to teach? What is it you're trying to teach me? What do you want to teach me through this? I'm listening. Teach me what you need to teach me. I want to be more like you. You know, I want to learn as much as I can about you. I want to be the best daughter that I can be for you. And And he does that, and he reveals himself more and more and more. The most helpful tip on my Christian walk is never, ever, ever blame God for anything that doesn't go to plan, okay, that doesn't go your way. If things happen and they're difficult, God's plan is always good for you. Just sometimes we're not very good at going God's way, because what we tend to do as our human nature is keep something back. You know, I've had plans for my life to do make certain decisions, and I could have made them, but God's plans are the ones that are perfect, and in those places there is so much blessing, and you don't have to strive for God's plans, you strive for your own. So it's good if you're striving for something, just think, you know, is that my plan or is that God's plan? Because God gives me everything that I need. He equips me for what he needs me to do. Next slide. So, next one. So that was, I'm really behind on, I'm waffling. Okay, we're going to read Jeremiah together. So Jeremiah 29, verse 11 to 14. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. That is like my story in the scripture. I'm like, yeah, he knows the plans that he has for me. He knows the plans that he has for you. His plans are to prosper you. His plans are to prosper me, not to bring harm on any of us. His plans are to give us a hope and a future. My hope is in him. My future is in him. So is yours. We pray. I pray to him. I listen to him. He guides my path. It's actually quite simple when you put it like that. I think we overcomplicate a lot of things in our Christian life. And it is that simple. We're listening to God. Now, I was sharing this with Phil as we were going on a walk. I think it's the next slide. So I was like, God, what's the purpose of all this? So when we were in Cornwall, I was sharing this as we were doing this walk with Phil. Now, I do love walking. Phil really doesn't like walking. He said, don't tell them that, but he really doesn't. He does it to keep me happy. And I don't just like walking. We're talking hiking, walking for miles in the wilderness, not on roads. It's where I can just see the beautiful things. I don't want to see the cars and the houses, though I am a nosy person when I'm walking. I do like to look in people's houses. But I just love to see the beautiful things around the world, and I think we've got a very beautiful country, and I want to explore it. So we were in Cornwall, and the first night we got there, we went on this very unusual walk. It felt a bit dangerous in places, and we ended up on this little beach. And we looked up, and right the beach was right down in the right-hand corner, but in the top left-hand corner is a lighthouse. And I saw this lighthouse, and I said to Phil, I really want to get to this lighthouse. I just want to walk there. And he was like, yeah, all right. And then we woke up one day, I was like, we're going on this walk, we're going to do this walk to this lighthouse. So we're walking on the tops of this Cornwall coast, and it is steep. And go, oh, you're doing it up for me. So yeah, there was, I don't know if we counted these steps, but it was really, really steep. And every time we got to the bottom of like a little hill or a steep cliff, a steep walk, feels like, can we go back? Is that it? And then it's like, oh, how much further? It's like a child in a car, we're nearly there yet. It's like, how much further? It's hot. He doesn't want to go. I'm like, just over the hill, Phil. So we go over the hill, still can't see the lighthouse because it's so far away. And with it being quite like this, you just couldn't see it, could we? And we got to places where we stopped. We looked out and was like, oh, this is just stunning. It's beautiful. See, Phil's face is like, yeah. I'm like, yeah. Phil's not all so impressed. But you were appreciating the beautiful views as well, weren't you? At any point on this journey, actually, about halfway through, we were both very hot. It was red hot, and we were satisfied, and we didn't have a backpack. We didn't take water and normal supplies for this very long walk in hot weather. And because I know about these things, I thought, no, let's just go for it. We're not going to die. It's only a 7-mile circular. We'll be fine. Anyway, yeah. So anyway, we kept on going, and next one, And the views were just stunning. So we're looking at a beautiful coastline. Phil, this was Phil's bit. He loved it. He was just stood for ages looking at his bird hovering over the ocean. Then I think you got it. And you got why I go on nice walks. We got to a point where we could have stopped and gone back because we were both actually very tired. We needed a drink. I could have gone back, been satisfied, had my ice cream because I'd earned it. But we decided, no, just as we were about to give up, we saw the lighthouse. It was still quite a distance away, but we saw it, and that encouraged us and motivated us to move on. So we kept going and going and going, and eventually we got to the lighthouse. Now, that was the lighthouse. We were going up to it. There's no light on it. I don't know why they call it a lighthouse. Maybe it's gone. Next one. And we were up there, and Faith and Daniel were down there. And I was like, Faith, can you see the lighthouse? Because we were right up there. So they were all down there at the bay getting their nice food whilst we were up there, hot and sweaty, dehydrated, no food, needing the toilet. It was a lot of fun. But when you got onto the top, what I noticed is I looked all the way around me, 360-degree, and the views, you've got to watch Phil. What's Phil doing on the next one? I'm appreciating the natural views. Phil is probably on his phone checking out the football scores. There he is. Yeah. But I was appreciating all the views. It's like, oh, wow, this is it. This is what it's all about. And as simple as this, what God said to me, he said, you know, on your Christian journey, in your Christian walk, I've been with you through it all, but there's times in your walk that you could have stopped with your gifting. And it was the gifting that God was particularly prompting me on. You could have stopped with your gifting and said, right, I'm satisfied, I'm happy with where I am. I don't need to do anything else. Is this temptation sometimes to go back and give it up? I've tried to retire a couple of years ago from the worship team here. I don't know if Daniel knew this, but I was saying to Phil, you know, I just want to let the young ones just go for it. I've done my time, I've done it for years. What did they do? But all put money together to buy me a new guitar. I was like, I can't do that. How do I do that? So I said, they got another couple of years out of me just by doing that. But when the journey gets harder, and it's not just about the gifting, but in your walk with God, we go through such interesting terrain when we can look at what's coming. Because sometimes we do see it and we're like, I just don't want to go there. I'm just going to stay here because I'm comfortable where I am. I don't need to do that because I still love you, Lord. It doesn't mean I don't love you. I just don't want to go there because I can see how steep it is and I can see that it's going to be difficult. I'm not going to enjoy it. I don't want to do it. But God wants us to keep going. He wants us to go through those situations. And on the walks, we didn't experience storms, but we know that when we're on generally in life, that I often say, you know, when things go difficult, it's like a storm. We go through a storm. There's always an end to it. But God expects us to walk through these things to see what he can teach us through these different situations. He gives us experiences so we can learn more about him, share his word, be a good witness to who he is. And this was the bit that I was saying to God, but what is it that you want me? If I'm going to share this, it's not just about me. It's what do you want to say to your people? And this is what I got this morning. And it was, again, back over Jeremiah. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me, and when you seek me with all your heart, I will be found, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord. So that's the scripture. And then I think back to when I was baptized, Proverbs 3, verse 5-6. Trust in the Lord God with all your heart. Don't lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. There is an expectation there that we do surrender to him. And very early on in our Christian ministry together, in fact, as soon as we went into Christian ministry, me and Phil always said, no matter what the cost, we would move and do whatever God wanted us to do. And that has been not pricey financially, though, yes, but it's so costly when you're moving your children from pillar to post. It's not actually been that many times. It's just like when we lived in St. Albans, for example, we lived in three houses. So we say we've lived in, we've actually only been in three or four churches, but they were still very difficult. And they were all part of God's training to bring us back to here. And this is what he was saying. This is what I wanted to pray over you guys this morning. To pray for people who've got weary and disillusioned on their journey. For people who have got injured on your journey. For those who are content and satisfied with where you are right now, it's not where you stop. God's got more for you. It's continuous. For those who are in the right place, but have not taken time to have a look around and see where God has you, just reopen your eyes. It's just that refocus on where God has you and what he wants to do through you and in you. And just that God has you. And it's time for many of you in here, and I did feel like it was many, it wasn't the ones and twos, to relight the fire for your servanthood. So I was like, God, is it not it's not lighting the fire, like it's in the passion, going back to first love? And he says, no, they love me. They already love me. But along the way, a lot of you have just almost given up in how you serve God. And he wants to get your back to doing exactly what he wants you to do. And it's very easy to sit and just let everything happen around you. I'm not talking about functioning within a church. That's part of it. My gifting, my main calling is actually out there. What we're doing here is to encourage one another. What I do out there is I share the love of Jesus. You know, whether it's the children in the classroom, influence the people around me, or whether it's your neighbours or the people you're at in the shop. That is my real calling and should be yours as well. You know, go forth, share the good news, witness, you know, be a resource. I love the vision for the house. Obviously, I know a little bit more, but I'll have to be careful. But I know that the vision of the house is to be a resource to the city. Because isn't that what the church is for? It's to look after people. It's to provide. It's to share, to show God's love. And that's what we're here for. But some of you are disillusioned and just, you're happy to let everyone else get on with it. I'm really thankful for my family that we do in ministry get stuck in, and a lot of you do. And I'm like, but God, you know, I am busy. As a teacher, we work, I can't tell you, but 12-hour days, easy, every day, throughout the weekend. It's not like that in all schools, but I have experienced that in the last couple of years. And where I'm absolutely exhausted, and I don't want to come on a Sunday because I'm exhausted. I just want to stay in bed. But I get up first thing in the morning. I want to be the first one here. I don't like being late. That's just me. Because I want to provide the best and to be part of God's house and be the best that I can be within God's house and serve you guys in the best way that I can. And I'm usually quite a quiet person. I like keep myself to myself. Yeah, I can be vocal on the stage, but that's because I love God so much with a passion that comes out in my worship. But he wants you to jump in as well. And yeah, I'm not going to talk any more on that. I just want to pray. And I do believe that God's just dropped little things in many of you. It might be that you look back and think, yeah, God, I see that you were here. I see that you were there. I can see that you've been with me in every detail in the journey. And I believe that he's revealed that to some of you already this morning. And I know that some of you, as I was going through my prayer points, are sitting there probably thinking, yeah, I am weary, I'm disillusioned, I have got injured. I am satisfied. I'm satisfied with where I am. I don't need to do anything else. Some of you might just, you know, you're where you need to be, but you're just not really looking around. You're not seeing what God has for you, because God has something for all of you. Ministry isn't about leading on stage. It's not about having a title. It's about being humble. It's one thing my pastor always taught me in Nottingham, in Derbyshire, in Homewood. He says, Helen, always stay humble. Don't ever let your ego go away with you. And I've always remembered that. It's always stuck with me. God looks for humble hearts, those who are willing to serve. We used to have a laugh in some of the churches, like, oh, Phil, some people just, it's like they want the name in lights. They're not going to be satisfied until their names are up there. It's about God and what we can do. Our relationship with him, how much are you loving on Jesus? Will prayed it in the prayer room this morning that we would just take time out just to hear God, just to really, you know, spend that time in his presence, not always being so busy. We're always so busy, but it's so important that we just take that time out to spend time just sitting at his feet. It's important to be doers, but it's more important, isn't it, just to listen, spend time with the Father. So if you could just be very gracious with me and just all just stand up, and then I'm not going to embarrass anybody. And just give an opportunity for prayer. There was a song that we were singing this morning, The Goodness of God, and I do want us to finish with that song. It just sums up, he's such a good, good God. Abby, could you just start playing that through for me, please? And then I'll pray, but I want to give some time. I'll hand back over to you in a minute, Phil and the team. But there should be time in our meetings for people to really be prayed for, and just setting you up for the week. And we're going to give that opportunity this morning. So, Father, I just thank you, Lord, for what you have done in my life. I thank you for the journey, this particular one that I shared this morning. I thank you, Father, that you have shown me how you have been in every detail on that particular journey. I thank you, Father, that you are real, that you are alive, that you are breathing, Father God, that your Holy Spirit dwells within me and within my brothers and sisters here today, Father, that we're here to share your love with each other, but also in the places that we influence, the places that you have put us in to make a godly difference. Father, I pray this morning, Lord, for the disillusioned Christians, Father, for those who are tired and weary, who have done the journey for so many years, they've seen it all, they've done it all, they're just weary, they're just happy to let people just get on, but they're just weary. Father God, will you relight their fires again, Father God? Will you set that little passion back in their hearts, Father God, where they just want to get straight back in and just serve you wholeheartedly, that they would go over and above, they would serve you with a diligence and with a passion, Father God, that all those little knocks that they've had along the way, Father God, we just pray for healing and restoration this morning. Father God, for those who have got injured in ministry, probably most of us carry some kinds of wounds, Father God, but you heal those wounds, you break us, you make us stronger, Father God, and because you show us your healing touch, you show us your grace in those situations, you show us that you walk with us through those situations, and you reveal more about yourself, and we thank you for that, Father. But I just pray, Holy Spirit, that you would just come to that special place this morning in people's lives. You know who they are, Lord, and we pray, Father God, that you would just make them stronger, Father God, that they would let go of those injuries, Father God, that they would realize who they are in you, that they still, or you still have a purpose and a plan for them, Father God, that you would restore them, Father, that they would be stronger than they were before because they know more about who you are through the journey that they've been on. Father God, for those who are satisfied with where they are, God, will you just stir them up, Lord? Will you just stir them up that they're no longer satisfied, Father God, that they would just hunger for more of you in their lives, that they would hunger and get back in that prayer room, that they would hunger to know more of you and more of what you want to in their lives, Father, that they would start sharing you with their friends again, Father, and with their families, that they wouldn't just be satisfied, but they would be hungry, Father God. And Lord, for those who feel like, no, everything's good, I'm in the right place, that's good. Because we all fit into these little areas and different points of our lives. But Father, we just pray that we would just take that time just to take a look around, just to sit at your feet, to listen to you, to be loved on by you, to hear your still small voice. that we would just surrender ourselves back to you again and say, yeah, Lord, use me however you want to use me. Where's the need, Lord? Where's the need? Show me the need and I will respond, because my purpose is to share your good news. Thank you, Father God, that you've done a tremendous work in so many of us, if not all of us in this place already. We have so much to share with the people around us, that we are all walking, living examples of the miracle that you are. And we thank you, Father God, for that reality and that truth. Thank you, Jesus, that you died on the cross and you rose again for me and for each and every person in this place, that you sacrificed, you took that burden, you took all the wrong things, the wrong thoughts, the things that we've carried in our lives, and you took them away from us, Father God, and you've given us your forgiveness. You're such a gracious Father, and we love you, and we thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. If there is anyone here this morning who really don't know what I'm talking about, but you do want to know more about Jesus, you want to know more about what or who he is and everything that I've shared this morning, if you want to know more, then do just come and have a little chat to myself, Phil, and any of the leaders, and we'll pray with you, and we'll teach you, we'll tell you who Jesus is. We'll share that with you, and we'll give that opportunity, and we'll pray with you. There's no life greater than having Jesus in yours, you know. He changes everything.
Yes. So just as Helen was encouraging us this morning, some of your journey and some of the things that she mentioned, if you're struggling with that, then just as we worship to finish, if you want to make your way to the front, Helen, myself, some of our heads of ministries, we'll just come and we'll just pray with you. One thing that really struck me is there's joy in the journey, but sometimes our joy gets stolen. Sometimes our journey becomes a chore rather than a joy. Yet every day with Jesus is supposed to be sweeter than the day before. And so sometimes that joy has been robbed. And so maybe some of the things that Helen's mentioned this morning, you just want a little bit of prayer. You just want God to come and touch and just change that around a little bit. And we want to encourage you as we worship, just come and just stand with us at the front. And we'll just take a moment just to pray over you. Amen. When we do finish, there's some tea and coffee. There's some soup at the back. We want to encourage you just to stand up, some fellowship with us at the end. But please do come if you want some prayer as we worship to finish. Thank you.
Your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love you, Lord. Lift your voice, for your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. Sing have your voice, and you have led me through the fire and the darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God all my life. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so
sing this again. If you just want some prayer, you want some ministry, please make your way to the front. We'll just take some time to pray with you and minister over you as we finish this morning. Thank you.
And all my life you have been faithful. And all my so, so good, with every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice, and you have led me through the fire and the darkest. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. Yes. All my life you have been faithful.
Of the goodness of God.
church. Musicians are just going to play gently in the background. There's a few more people that just want some prayer. But we're going to pray as we finish this morning. I want to encourage you to stay behind, have some fellowship, and have some tea and coffee and some soup with us this morning. Don't forget Wednesday night, 7:30, Friday night, 7:30. If you can make it, we'd love to see you as we study and as we pray together. Father, thank you for the journey that we've been on this morning with you. Father, it's an absolute pleasure to walk with you. There's nowhere that you've not walked before. Lord, your word says you've even walked in the recesses of the deep. And so, Father, the journey that we're on, the walk that we are in life right now, God, you've already walked it before. You've already been there. So nothing surprises you. Nothing defeats you. Nothing upsets you. God, you're just an incredible God. You're an incredible partner to walk with and for us to be partnered with. And Lord, I pray this morning for those who are being prayed for and for the rest of us, God, in this week that lies ahead, Father, as we continually walk in with you. Father, be everything that we need you to be, Father. Be our strength. Be our courage. Be everything that we need, Father. And Father, may this week be a journey, be a walk of intimacy, a place of, Lord, that we've never been before in that deep place with you. As Helen has encouraged us this morning, just to get alone in the room and just worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, seal what you've done in our hearts and our lives this morning that will bring forth fruit, and that fruit will remain. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Good to see you. Please stay behind, have some fellowship. Really great to see you. Please be aware that we have some people just being ministered to this morning as well. We'll continue with that. And please, if you've not made your way forward and you still need to, then please, there's still time to do that. We'd love to take some time just to pray over you. But God bless you, and we'll see you soon.